Okay, we're live.
We're in the fellowship hall.
Can't stop it.
So much fellowship.
Right.
Wait a minute.
So in the Army, it's traditional to make an announcement that's like, it's 5 minutes before the service starts, silence your phones and sit down. And then about 30 seconds later, they say, welcome to the start of the ceremony. So that's where I learned to do this. Welcome to the beginning of the service. It has not been 1 minute, but we're going to go ahead and start. Welcome to worship here at First Christian Church of Decatur. I'm so happy to see all of you who are here, all of you who are still arriving, and all of you who are online. I'm here to bring you your worship theme for the day. This is from a song called Cry for Love by Michael W. Smith. If you were listening to Christian music in the 90s, you might know it. If not, then get there. I will not sing it, thank you very much. I will read it for you. I will be the first to admit, I don't have the strength to handle it alone anymore. I don't have to fret, don't have to explain, all my worryings in vain. I'm not alone anymore. Like the changing of seasons, this is the beauty of the word. And for all that I have seen and heard, oh, I want to come home. Somehow I'll make my way home to you. Can you hear me? I'm calling out. I'm crying out. I cry for love. Let's worship.
Inspired and informed by God's love, mercy, and justice, we are purposefully involved in the healing and helping of our community and our world. We covenant with God and the greater community to nurture a spirit of love and service to neighbors, honor one another's differences, and fellowship in the breaking of the bread. Actively striving to honor each other's race, age, sexual orientation, gender identity, nationality, ethnicity, marital status, physical or mental ability, family configuration, political affiliation, economic circumstance, or theological perspective. We truly welcome all. And I love it. Today, I'm Ryan McGinnis, and I'm joined by wonderful Adam Cole and William Garner. We have Marcus Hill with us. We'll be singing. Before that, and we're also joined by Reverend Dr. Jerry Gladson and Daniel Brown. Thank you. A couple of announcements. First, I'd like to get out of the way. Thank you to everybody who donated supplies, their time, money for the Westmont stroll yesterday that I heard went off without a hitch, right? Yeah, nothing bad, no rain or anything. So that was great. Today, immediately after church at noon, if you're involved, we do have a board meeting. And it looks like tonight, looks like the kids are going to have some fun. There's youth night. Thursday, September 14th, I don't know how to pronounce it, Taze, okay, thank you. Prayer vigil at St. Thomas More at 7:30 p.m., that's on Thursday, that's coming Thursday. At St. Thomas, or St. Simon's Island from Friday, September 22nd through the 24th, there's a Disciples Women's Retreat. That sounds like fun. A big one is our Christmas tree planting sale, or meeting on September 24th, Sunday at noon. So we're going to be planning that. It's going to be big this year. We want to, I think we really want to focus in on this. This would be one great way to honor Reverend James. So I hope that we can all do as much as we can to help volunteer and work the Christmas tree sale this year. I think would be great. And thank you. And if you guys would, for our opening hymn, if you guys rise if you'd like. Page 16, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
God's people. God raises up the poor and endows them with salvation.
Let God's people erupt in praise, singing triumphantly wherever they are.
Praise the eternal God forever.
And now the unison prayer of invocation.
O living God, past and future, we praise you for this present moment. Fill us with your joy and empower us with your Holy Spirit, that our strength may be renewed to sing a new song of your glory in a world which longs for your justice and peace. All this we ask in the name of Jesus, in whom we become your creation.
Son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant region. And there he squandered his wealth in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that region, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that region, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him any. But when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far away, his father saw him, was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God."
We come now to the time in our service where we lift up before God and one another the joys and concerns of our church and community. If you look in your bulletin, just flip open the back cover and there it is. You'll see some of the concerns that we have written down. But are there any that aren't listed in the bulletin that we need to particularly remember today?
My son Thomas and his dear longtime friend Luke on the death of Luke's younger brother Matt.
Jeanette's mother is in the emergency room with pneumonia. So just prayers for her.
Anybody else? God, we thank you for this gathering of motivated, dedicated, loving, and caring leaders. God, these are your people, and you delight in them. Thank you for gathering us all here with the common purpose of serving our community, loving you, and showing that love to the wider world. Thank you for those among us who have been here for ages and ages and ages. Thank you for those among us who are new to our congregation. Thank you for those who are just visiting with us today. God, we thank you for each and every person who is here in this room or watching online or will be watching in the far future. You have called and gathered every single one of us to this place for a purpose. We may or may not know what that is, but we thank you for it until we figure it out. God, we thank you for the joys that we have in our lives, the great ones in our community, the small ones that are within our personal family, and the victories that some people may not even know about that are personal to us alone. God, you are in every single joy, and we thank you unendingly for them. But as you are with us in joy, we know you are with us in sorrow as well. God, we lift up before you all who are sick and injured today, all who are hurting and grieving and in pain. God, you know the cries of our hearts, and you know even the things that we can't even put into words. You know the things that are weighing on us, troubling us, occupying our thoughts. God, in particular today, we lift up Thomas and Luke, Luke's family. We lift up Jeanette and Ryan, Bobette, she's in the hospital. God, we lift up Lily. We lift up all of those who we haven't spoken out loud but still are in our hearts and our minds. God, you know us better than anyone alive. You know us better than we know ourselves. And you know the things that we need, the things that we want, things that we don't even know we need and want. Thank you for that. Thank you for giving us each good gift, strength for the day, courage for the journey. Hear us now as we pray the prayer that your Son taught us to pray while on his journey, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Looks like the Lord brought Lily right in. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I heard the Andrew Thomas sing this a few weeks ago, so I'll try. As well. So I told her, I texted her this morning, I said, so it looks like I'll be singing the lower version of I'm Right on King Jesus. I knew. You. Don't watch. So.
Right on, King Jesus, no man can hinder me. Right on, King Jesus, right on, no man can hinder me. Right on, King Jesus, no man.
Jesus.
first amen to that.
Thank you.
Well, as I look around the room, I see a number of faces that I'm familiar with. I've met many of you in various regional events and even here at the church over a period of time that I've been here in the Atlanta area. Thank you for inviting me. It is a distinct honor to come to this church and to preach here where my friend James preached for so many years. He's James to me. I know most people, Reverend Doctor and so forth, but he's James to me. He and I, Betty, along with him, and my wife Laura and I came into this region at the same time, about the same time. So we have been colleagues together for these many years. James and I served on the commissional ministry for years here in Georgia. James was, in my mind, a pastor's pastor. And he was a nurturer of pastors. He loved the ministry. He loved doing what he was doing. And it showed in all that he did. So I'm honored to stand here in a pulpit that I'm sure he shared from time to time, and to preach from it this morning. In the scripture that we have read, Ryan read a moment ago, you heard what has been called the greatest short story ever told. Great artists such as Dürer and Rembrandt have told it with delicate oils on canvas. Dramatists, choreographers, novelists, philosophers, even the atheist Nietzsche paid it honor. It echoes across the centuries in every culture and in every art. It has been the pattern for many short stories after it to this very day. But it is, in short, gospel in Jesus' words. It comes as a part of a series of parables. There are actually five parables in Luke 15 and 16, flow almost simultaneously across the pages. It is prefaced here by an introductory scene where people were gathering around Jesus. And the people who were gathering around Jesus are the telones, the tax collectors, and the sinners, it says. These were people that were viewed by the religious leaders of the day as not being really careful to keep up with all of the rules and regulations that pertain to the oral tradition. And so they were regarded as kind of excluded from the leadership and excluded from pious people. They were the unwashed, the unclean. And these people associated around Jesus a lot. In fact, they were very interested in what he had to say in all the stories that we have in the New Testament. There are three parables that precede, or two parables that precede this one in Luke 15, and they're all about something being lost. And the first one is the lost sheep, the sheep that wanders away. In the second one, it's the lost coin. And in the third one, it is, as the German Bible has it, the lost son. This parable tells of a man. It could be any person, man or woman, who has been a parent before. This man had two sons. The younger of them, it seems, was dissatisfied with his present environment. We don't know what it was about his whole life. Maybe there were too many rules around his whole life, whatever it may have been, but he was dissatisfied. He wanted to break, get away from the country. And so he demands his inheritance early, before it is due him. Now, in the custom of the times, he would be scheduled eventually to receive one-third of the property. His older brother, whom we hear about later in the story, would have gotten two-thirds. But somehow, he works out a deal with his father, and the father gives him his inheritance. I don't know whether he had to sell some stocks, property, or whatever, to get the money together to give this to his son, but he does. And the son then takes off. It goes to a far distant country. That's significant in the story. A far distant country. Perhaps to try to get some distance here, away from his family. He puts distance between himself and his family as much as he can, away from the home he once knew. He wants that in his past. He wants new, exciting adventures. When I read this, I think of myself at about 18. I had the same feelings. I intended to get away, go somewhere far off, away from home. Well, this young man wants to do that. Once there, he recklessly squanders, scatters, disperses, wastes, the Greek word in the translation, his money in living fast and loose lives, wine, women, and song. That was his story. He throws his money away on every conceivable pleasure that may have presented itself, every indulgence. Were he in our culture, he probably would have indulged in coke and meth and all the drugs that are out there, fentanyl and so forth. Anything for the thrill. He indulges them all. He reminds me, in many ways, of the way in which we try to distance ourselves from our background. A student that I taught in college. Later, after he graduated, went to Vanderbilt University, my alma mater, to work on his PhD. I kind of lost track of him after that. But there, he abandoned his faith. He sent me a letter, which I'd like to read. He wrote to me as though I were some kind of father confessor, and he needed to confess. He said this, "Strangely enough, I find that my day-to-day existence is not greatly impoverished as a result of my jettisoning my faith. Though I will admit, there are times that I bemoan the lack of overall purpose and cohesiveness of my life. I have made up my mind about two things. One, there is or did exist a God. And two, we know nothing about him. He or she is hidden." That sentence brought up memories of a lot of conversations I'd had with this particular student about the hiddenness of God in contemporary society. But he was telling me here that he had left his faith. I don't know what happened to him. As far as I know, he's still out there in a distant country, having left his faith. The young man in our story wakes up one morning to find that he has no money in his bank account. He's just gotten his bank statement. Life suddenly turns mean and harsh. A severe famine. Might be thinking of it as an economic recession. Now he's forced to take the most menial job that you can imagine for a young Jewish man, feeding pigs, unclean pigs. Christ said this in the Talmud: cursed be the man who would breed swine. He's forced to take on that kind of job. He hits bottom, as they would say in the recovery community. He hits bottom. There's nowhere farther to fall than he has come. More humbly still, he not only keeps swine, he has to eat their food. And the food, as the text describes it, is probably carob pods. They were used at the time for animal fodder. Now the carob pod is full of a dark, syrupy, honey-like substance. And in our time, it has been used to make a substitute for chocolate. Go buy carob bars in the stores that are made from these very pods that he had apparently used to feed the pigs. And that's what he's eating, is from that sort of thing. Pig's food he's eating. And no other food than that. He had bought it. Recovering addicts talk about this. They talk about that moment when there came desire to realize that something had to change. He hit bottom. And so he remembers. He remembers back home, when a home never seemed so wonderful as it does from a far country, a distant memory. He remembers his home where he had food and clothing. He's clothed in rags. He remembers the shelter that he had there, the companionship. And here he is, tending swine. Home never looked so inviting as it did. And so he resolves, I'm going to go back. Do whatever it takes to go back. Will he be accepted? Will he be rejected for what he has become? Clothed in rags. Will the door be closed to him? He steals up his will and his mind, and he rehearses what he's going to say if he ever gets back there. Father, I have sinned. I am no longer worthy. Take me home as a hired servant. He no longer has any claim on any of the property of his father. He can no longer be considered a son as far as the thing is concerned. He's legally dead. He's gone. Will he be accepted? He doesn't know. But he resolves to go back. And across the miles he goes, long dusty roads, probably most of it on foot, hungering, begging for food as he goes along, going back to that distant land. Meanwhile, back home, his father, we might imagine, many days, comes out on the front porch and looks down that road that the son once trod as he went away. Looks down that road, winding as it does into the distance. And he wonders, will I ever see him again? The tears. But every day, or every few days, he goes out there and he looks down the road. Will I ever see him again? Then one day he's doing that. And he sees a solitary figure coming down the road. He squints because his eyesight is now failing a bit. He squints. It is him. And so he gathers up his cloak and he runs. Now it was considered unseemly for a grown man to run in those days, but he runs out there. And somewhere down that road he meets the son, and the son comes up to him and he blurts out those words, Father, I've sinned against you and against God. And the father shuts him up. shuts him up and bids him. And he commands one of his slaves, go back home and get the robe. Wouldn't it have been something if that were the robe that the son abandoned when he left? It's been mended, cleaned, and hung in the closet. Grab the robe, put it around him. Bring out the signet ring. That was the ring that made him a part of the family. This official signet ring. Bring that out. Put that on him. For this, my son, has come back. He was dead, and he is alive again. Now, it would be wonderful if the story ended there. We would just celebrate. We only read a portion of it earlier, of that, of this whole scene. But it doesn't end there. There is an older brother who is out in the fields working. You're the one who stayed by the stuff, carried out the family legacy, worked the crops, worked the farm, did all those things that you'd expect this son to do. He comes in and he hears this party going on and he finds out what it's about. His lost brother, the other son, has come back and has been welcomed with a party. The older son refuses to go into the party. And he tells the father, you know, I've stood by you all these years, but you've never given me a party like this. His older son represents those religious leaders and others who reject the broken people of the world, who refuse them the right to come to Jesus. Did the older son ever enter? We don't know. Did he ever go into the party? Did he ever reconcile? We don't know. Jesus loved to end these stories, these parables. I'll leave you hanging, let you go home and figure it out. The son never entered. The older son was unable to comprehend the glorious grace of God that embraces all. We see ourselves in this story. Let me speak for myself. I see myself here in this story. I can remember my adolescent rebellion. I can remember saying to myself that when I turn legal age, I am going to get out of here. I am going to leave the church. I'm going to leave God behind and be done with it all. Perhaps you can remember a time when you make such statements as that. I would be alienated from my family. The appeal, the exotic, the new, the foreign, the things that were out there were present as temptations. But there was a time when, like the prodigal son, the lost son, that I had a moment of self-awareness. Our text says, when he came to himself, an awakening. A repentance. I had said in those years that I would never be Christian. I had said I would never go into the ministry. I had a man who suggested that's what I ought to do. I said I would never do it until I had that awakening. The joy of reunion, repentance, the power of forgiveness, the dynamics of love, the faithfulness, and the compassion of God. Some years ago, when I was at Vanderbilt University, I did the prison ministry. Stan, you can identify with that. In the state penitentiary, which was nearby. And there I met a man who had been convicted of murder. He was undergoing a 99-year sentence for murder. But while in there, he found God, and he had a real sharp mind. He began to read all kinds of theological literature. And he would write in long letters in which we would dialogue about these theological views. One day he sent me a quotation from the late Paul Tillich. I had not seen it before, since I've gotten the book where it's found, but it is one of the most profound statements I've ever read about the grace of God. I'm going to share it with you. Grace strikes us when we are in great pain and restlessness. Sometimes, at that moment, a wave of light breaks into our darkness, and it is as though a voice were saying, "You are accepted. You are accepted. Accepted by that which is greater than you, in the name of which you do not know. Do not ask for that name now. Perhaps you will find it later. Do not try to be anything now. Perhaps later you will be much. Do not seek for anything. Do not redeem anything. Do not perform anything. Do not intend anything. Simply accept the fact. You are accepted." That's God's grace. It might be that there are folks here who need to come home. And if that is you, or someone you know, the door's open. Welcome. Find your way back. Let us pray. Precious God, we hear and we feel the force of this great story. For we feel it resonating in our own lives. Oh God, we are grateful and thankful to you for the welcome that you have given us in the church and with others. Thank you. In Jesus' name.
I've never had the honor and the privilege of working retail, but I have worked fast food before, and I hear that this experience is common among both. You get someone who really wants something they can't have, and so finally they're like, fine, then I'll take my business elsewhere. Please. The story of the prodigal son is a wonderful message of hope that if you are gone, if you are lost, you will be accepted back with open arms and a party. But then there's the older brother who has been there the whole time and has never got the party. And so he walks up to the party and he goes, fine, I'll take my party elsewhere. And the compulsion is like, man, you've been a part of this family for years. I tell you every day I love you and appreciate you because you're my son. And you're going to pitch a fit because you don't have a party? Please take your business elsewhere. But here's the good news. Just because you might not want to go into the party, you're still accepted at the party. If you are feeling like, what about me? You're still accepted. You are accepted whether you're lost or you're found, whether you feel like it or not, whether you have a good attitude about it or not. You are accepted. And not only accepted by God, but I'm going to venture to say accepted by the community of God. And you are accepted here at this table. This table does not require you to be a member of this church. It doesn't require you to feel good about being here today. It doesn't require you to do any kind of thing except be you. This is God's table, and you are accepted here. Here among this community of believers, we do communion by intinction, which means that you'll come forward, take a piece of the bread dipped in the cup, and then eat it. If for any reason you are not comfortable participating in this way, or you need a gluten-free option, there are pre-filled individual cups in a basket over at the front entrance. And if for any reason you are not participating in this at all today, you are still accepted, you are still welcome, and you are still loved. Let us pray.
Gracious God, we come to this welcome table, thankful from the bottom of my heart for this bread and this cup and what they represent, your grace extended to us in even these physical elements. And so we ask you to bless them, bless this bread, bless this cup, to the nurture of our souls as we partake together in this fellowship. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, I received what I also delivered to you, how on the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread and he blessed it, he gave it to them, saying,
this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
In the same way, he took the cup, and when he blessed it, he said, this cup
is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it. In remembrance of me.
For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you remember the Lord until he returns.
Thank you.
life eternal. We pray that you are giving us all good gifts in him, and pledge ourselves to serve you, even as in Christ you have served us. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is number 436. Shalom to you now, number 436. We'll sing it through twice.
Of the Creator, the Word of God, and the Spirit of God. Go in peace, and the blessings rest upon you.